Hello everybody, my name is Denis and you are watching Close to Algo Trading. Today we are going to check most useful methods from tf.data.dataset API. And as TensorFlow says, the tf.data API enables you to build complex input pipelines and make it possible to handle large amount of data and perform complex transformation. The tf.data API introduces a tf.data dataset abstraction. They represent a sequence of elements in which each element consists of one or more components. There are two ways to create a dataset: construct dataset from data stored in memory or in one or more files, and construct dataset from one or more TensorFlow dataset objects. In my examples, I will create dataset from the data stored in memory. For other methods, I would recommend to check official TensorFlow documentation. Let's start. First of all, we need to import TensorFlow library and set the random seed to be able to reproduce our results. We can create TensorFlow dataset from a simple NumPy array. What we need is just to pass our array into the fromTensorSlice methods. As you may see, we have an array that consists of three arrays of three elements. Our dataset will contain three one-dimensional tensor of three elements. The dataset object is Python iterable. This makes it possible to consume its elements using a for loop. And another useful option is to use sNumPyIterator method, which returns an iterator which converts all elements of the dataset to NumPy. After we execute this code, we can see the following output. Our dataset consists of three elements. Each element is one-dimensional tensor of three values. Most of the time, you will not want to see all dataset, but only few elements. To take first two elements from the dataset, we can use method take. So, dataset is created. Let's go to the batch. Normally, you will use batch method at the end of your pipeline most of the time. Batch combines elements of this dataset into batches. Let's get batches of two elements from our dataset. As a result, we have two tensors, one that contains two elements, as we defined batch of two, and another one contains only one element, because there are not enough data to construct full batch of two elements in the rest of our dataset. In the case you don't need partly constructed batch, you can set drop reminder parameter to true. You may see how the batch method changes your dataset. It creates new elements with new shape. As we have batch method, we also have unbatch. Unbatch splits element of dataset into multiply elements. Assume that your original dataset consists of two tensors, each with the shape 3-3. But we don't want that shape and want to have six tensors instead. Then we can use unbatch method. Next method is repeat. This method repeats the dataset so each original value is seen counts times. Interesting, but the parameter of this method defines how many times you will see your original dataset in a new one. Normally, you will start from value 2, because 0 and 1 don't make a lot of sense. If you put 0, you will not have data at all, and if you put 1, you will have your original dataset. If you want to repeat the dataset infinitely, then don't define any input parameters. Now we can try to use batch and repeat together. If we batch our dataset two times and then repeat it two times, we will have new dataset which consists of four tensors, two full and two not. But sure, we can change the order and first repeat our dataset and then get batches. And if we repeat our dataset only once, we will have dataset with six tensors and then take batches of two. We will have a new dataset with three tensors each of two elements. Next method is shuffle. It randomly shuffles the elements of this dataset. The most important here is to understand how it works. I created a small video with animation to show how the batch, repeat and shuffle works. Don't forget to check it on my channel. Well, in the shuffle method, you define the shuffle buffer size. The dataset fills a buffer with buffer size elements, then randomly samples elements from this buffer, replacing the selected elements with the next element from original dataset. For perfect shuffling, a buffer size greater or equal to the full size of the dataset is required. Well, if we set shuffle buffer to 2, our first element always will be 0 or 1, because first two elements will be taken from the original dataset. Then, when one of these elements selected and taken from the shuffle buffer, next element, in our case number 2 from the original dataset, will be taken. With this logic in the second position in our new dataset, we can have only 0, 1 or 2, and so on. But if we set shuffle to the length of our dataset, we will have shuffle over the entire dataset. We can execute this code many times and compare how the new dataset looks with different shuffle buffer size. Shuffle method has one useful parameter, reshuffle each iteration. It controls whether the shuffle order should be different for each epoch. If we set this parameter to false and then repeat and batch our dataset, we will get the same result for all repeated datasets. Look here, I have repeated dataset 3 times and batched with 3 elements. Each batch is one copy of original dataset. The result is all 3 tensors in our new dataset have the same shuffled values. But if we set reshuffle each iteration to true and repeat our test, you may see that our 3 tensors have different order of elements. So, we have reviewed the 3 most used methods, but it's not all. I think we should look at some more methods that are extremely useful. First 2 of them are apply and map. Both methods are used for data transformation, but there is one difference between them. Map works on elements, and apply works on complete dataset. Map maps function across the elements of this dataset. Simplest way to understand how it works is to add print method into the function. Our dataset consists of 3 elements, and the map function was called 3 times, every time before we get element from the dataset. I created a function that shuffles values in element. Parameter x in our function is one element from the dataset. And as element from dataset is a tensor, we can perform all possible operations that we can do with tensors. Result of our pipeline will be dataset with 3 tensors, where values inside the tensor are shuffled. As all methods of dataset, map can be used in any place in your pipeline. Interesting. If you will put batch before map, it looks like the random generator will be reinitialized. You can see that the elements are the same here and not the same here. The dataset has one more method for transformation. This method is apply. This method applies the transformation for the complete dataset. The main change is visible here. When we execute our pipeline with apply methods, we may see the print message only once, not 3 times as with map. Also, you may notice that the value passed into the function is not a tensor, but a dataset. To show how it is working, I created a function that scales all values in dataset to the range from 0 to 1. First, I find min and max values in the entire dataset, and then using these values, I perform a scaling of values in each element. In our original dataset, we have value from 1 to 9, and our new dataset has scaled values. Easy to spot that our original 1 now is 0, and our original 9 now is 1. To find min and max value, I use another method of dataset, reduce. Reduce method gets function as a parameter with 2 inputs. First input parameter is a result of previous call of this function. and the second parameter is next element from dataset. Reduce function returns a value. Also, dataset API has a method that helps to select only the elements interesting to us. Filter method. The filter method is quite simple. You need to implement a function that will check some conditions, and if element meets this condition, the function should return true, if not, then false. New dataset will contain only elements that meet the conditions. For demonstration, I created a filter to select all elements where the first element of array is less than 5. The next two methods that I would like to consider are concatenate and zip. I will not stop on concatenate because it's quite simple and does exactly what it's supposed to do. It concatenates two datasets. Zip is also simple. It creates a dataset by zipping together the given datasets. But you need to remember that after zipping you still have two datasets. So, if you want to use map function after zip, you need to implement your function with two input parameters. One for element from first dataset and the other for element from the second dataset. And your function can return transform data as zipped elements or as one new. So, the last method that I want to show is window method. Window combines input elements into a dataset of window, but it's simple to show with an example as to try to describe how it's working. This method has four input parameters. Size defines the window size. The shift argument determines the number of input elements by which the window moves on each iteration. The stride argument determines the stride of the input elements, and we have here already known drop reminder. If we set size to 3 and don't define shift and set stride to 1, we will have a new dataset that consists of 3 elements with 3 values. But if we set shift to 1, we will get another result. New elements will contain 3 values shifted by 1 in each next element. Using the window method can help us create input data for RNN network. Let's check an example. Assume that we have the following dataset, and we want to create an input sequence to our network with 3 elements. Also, we want to calculate percentage change in each sequence over the columns. For that task, the transformation function could be as following. First, we will get sequence from our dataset using the method window. Then, we need to convert our windows into the tensors. We need to use flat map methods and batch our dataset to the batches equal to the window size. I don't know why TensorFlow team doesn't create it by default. After that, we can add map function that will transform our elements. We created a function that works on an entire dataset. So, let's pass this function to apply method and check the result. We have new dataset that consists tensors with a sequence of 3. And the same function we can apply, for example, for stock price dataset. Well, that's all. I hope that was interesting, and I really appreciate if you reach this point. Please don't hesitate to leave the comments and subscribe to the channel. See you in the next video.